Hey everyone, and welcome to Cinematography Database Show. My name is Matt Workman, and this episode we're going to break down the cinematography of Selena Gomez, Good For You. Good For You. I'm in my marquee diamonds. I'm a marquee diamond. Could even make that Tiffany jealous. You say I give it to you hard. So bad, so bad. Make you never wanna leave. I won't. Okay, so here we are. Let's get into Photoshop. For those of you that were asking, this is done in Photoshop. Pretty simple screen record happening here. And I have this new setup so that I can kind of quickly go from making stuff to recording to making stuff, not have to move my camera around and eventually be doing live streaming, that sort of thing. So, here we are. The cinematography of Selena Gomez, Good For You, again, hand-drawn by this guy. Let's look at our slate. That's how I like to start these so far. This is directed by Sophie Muller. Pretty big director. She's been around for a while, doing amazing work. And makes a lot of sense for Selena to actually tap Sophie for this music video, and we'll talk about that in a second. And it's shot by Mr. Peter Vermeer. Vermeer is a cool last name to have for a DP, because Vermeer was an old school Renaissance painter, and DPs love painters. So let's start by digging into this first image. This is my favorite setup for the whole music video. I'm going to start there. And I think what we can call this setup at first is just dark, right? I mean, all this background is this very dark tone. And even when we look at Selena's face here, if we do this and her arm, this is called half light. And it's called half light because half of her face is dark or half of it is bright. And if you look at her eye, her right eye, really dark, you barely see any detail. And that's not really that common for music videos. It's really not common at all to do that. And the reason is because it's dark and it's not that flattering, but just like the last Justin Bieber video I broke down, Selena Gomez as an artist, as a person, as a human being, she's getting older, and her music is reflecting that, and she wants the imagery that goes with that music to be a little bit more real, a little bit more mature. So we see this kind of like darker, more narrative aesthetic, and Sophie Muller, I forget how you pronounce her last name, you know, she's kind of known for that, for these kind of like more mature branding of artists. So that's why we see this type of imagery, and I think that's pretty cool to see that. I don't personally do a lot of dark imagery. I wish I could. This is kind of like a Bradford Young music video, though his would probably be even darker than this. So here's that same setup. We're going to get into how he did that in a little bit. But it's the same lighting setup, but it's a little bit brighter in that we have this wood palette, this wood kind of textured wall, but still dark over here, but she's a little bit backlit. But you'll see that the shadow part of her face here, it's very small. So she's actually facing the key light in this one. So it's a way of taking that kind of darker setting up and making it a little bit brighter and making more setups out of it. And again, this pose, this is the, that pose. You should know about that pose if you're a photographer or a director. So here's our behind the scenes shot. It's a little bit dark, but I'm going to try to call out bits here. This is, I think, an 8x ultra bounce. So basically you're seeing the black side. On the other side of that thing is white. And they're bouncing a light that's kind of like right here. It's bouncing into this. And then there's another 8x diffusion. And so the light's bouncing from here through there. Hard to see, but that's kind of like the wide shot of it. It's the best thing they had. And here we are inside of that setup when we go inside of the tent. I'll go back and forth for a second. So here's the key light. And there inside there, this is us jumping inside of it. So here's Selena Gomez performing again. This side, very dark to camera. And we see Peter here operating the camera. He's doing kind of like a high angle shot. But what's important to see here is that there's this bounce happening, but what's happening is there's these solids or these black pieces of fabric that are blocking light. So it's essentially making the light source smaller in a certain sense. And what's happening is that there's light coming through there and hitting her. But what it's not doing is it's not hitting the floor and bouncing up, and it's also not hitting the ceiling and coming down. So that's what's happening here. This type of flagging and called, you know, controlling of large light sources. I have a tutorial on that. If you go to cinematographydb.com, there's a tutorial on how to do this type of controlling of large light sources. The last thing I want to call out here is that we have our window, which I believe is probably just natural daylight. So kind of a low light scene. This is coming through here and backlighting Selena Gomez. Next. So this is like kind of the flip side of that setup. And now's a good time to talk about what's going on with the camera. So here, this is a cartoony two-axis Lambda head. I use this head a lot, and it allows you to put the camera really low to the ground really quickly. And we'll talk about the camera later, but this contraption, if you've never seen it, is called a Z-jib. And it's this mechanical arm that, you know, rotates from here, it rotates up there as a joint, and it rotates at auto levels there. So what Peter can do is he can basically move the camera in a straight line like this, like he can move it side to side, and he can make arcs. So basically, like, kind of like zero gravity to the camera anywhere you want. And it's even more flexible than like a Fisher jib, which is what I basically use. I use a Fisher jib just like this with the two-axis head. Lots of set photos, that's like how I work all the time. But this one's like even one step better because you can move straight. So it's like using the Fisher cross arm. But we'll talk about Fisher stuff probably in a course. There's a lot to talk about with Fisher jibs and how you move them and how you get certain feels. Everyone's probably on that gimbal stuff right now, but when that stuff kind of becomes less fashionable, and this type of shooting and this type of equipment is really, really good and really solid. The last thing I want to call out here is, again, we have our booklet coming from this direction, is we have this KinoFlow. I think it's a 4x4. 4x2, and there's opal in front of it, and it's basically just like a big soft light, rectangular soft light, and that's being used as a local fill or an eye light. So we have this kind of sidey dark light, but then Peter takes this smaller light, still soft, and just makes it a little bit more frontal. So we have a kind of like a side light coming like this, and then more of like a an eye light coming from this direction. Hope that makes sense. There's a lot more examples of that as we go forward, breaking down this music video. So again here, here's another shot of that eye light. So it's definitely a 4x2, I believe. It's only gonna be about that big. And it's being held by one of the crew members that's kind of floated around. That's again a very like photo style thing to do, is to have someone Hollywood or just hold and dynamically move a fill light around. It's a very photography style of working. Did another cool shot of the Z-jib. And here, what I want to call out here is not so much anything here. We've already seen that. What you'll see is this light there. You know, what's going on there? You'll see that it's actually not really edge lighting Selena Gomez. You'll see that it's hitting the camera. So it's flaring the camera out. And I think we saw that light in this setup. You'll see it's here. And there's actually someone holding it. So we see this kind of Joker. Maybe it's like an airy, it actually looks like an airy pocket light or pocket par. So it's a very like 125 watt small HMI, and it's got black wrap around it. So it's kind of making the beam smaller. But you'll see he's just shooting it off in the background. It's like, what's happening with that light? What's happening is that he's shooting it at the camera, and let's look at the effect that that has. So here again, book light coming from this direction, a little bit of edge light, soft stuff, soft lighting happening here. And what happens is that when he hits the camera with that pocket par, you get this this flare, this veil. And this character, every lens has a different characteristic of what happens when light hits the lens directly. And light hits the front of the lens and it bounces around inside of it and it comes out in different ways. And almost 100% Peter chose these lenses because they flare in this way, which is this soft, veily way. There's really not a lot of actual flare. It's very veiled out. And another important note, this looks like it might be a 50. Each prime, each different focal length within a set of lenses actually flares differently. That's not something that I knew right away when I was shooting music videos and doing flares like this. It's like you actually have to pick a set of lenses and then actually pick a focal length and then look at the flare you like. So you end up using that focal length kind of for the whole shoot if that's the flare that you really like. Some people wanted to know more about the lenses and stuff. So here we have our vintage lens, and it's clearly a spherical lens. I don't know what it is. It's very small, so it looks like it could be like a standard speed or a Cook Pancra. I'm not that big of a lens nerd. You guys tell me what this lens is, if you can tell by looking at it. And he's using a 1/8 black Pro Mist, which is going to more or less diffuse the blacks a little bit, make them a little bit softer. And you know, with this edgy kind of darker lighting, it helps kind of smooth out the transition from dark to light. That's what's kind of happening. And 1/8 is pretty subtle, almost not even noticeable, though it's kind of noticeable with a flare. Though I'm not sure where this filter is. Usually it's in a matte box. I don't know where it is in here, but his ACs have called out that there's a black Pro Mist somewhere in the optical system here. Last, shooting 48 frames per second for some ablibs, so a little bit of slow motion stuff. Not singing necessarily. Just performing, doing some kind of like B-roll shots 180 shutter, and he does this for the whole video. He rates the Alexa, or sorry, the Amira at 4800 Kelvin, 5400 Kelvin, sorry, and that basically makes daylight, because they're using HMIs that are 5600 or 5500, it makes it like slightly warmer, almost imperceivably warmer, and that's just going to help you know, Selena's skin tone to be a little bit warmer. And here, in this is kind of a cool shot, we see the window in the back. So when you're watching the setup, this is a real window, and then we have our book light, maybe a little bit of natural return, and then the flare lens, or the flare light, rather. So that is this setup. Pretty cool, I like it. So let's talk about this one. So this is that same location, I believe, but we'll see here, let's talk about the color palette. We have this kind of like, I would say, a dark tone cyan, and then in the back we have this same dark color cyan in it, but we have this paisley floral pattern that's kind of this lighter green, and that lighter green matches this couch here. And this is a very photo shoot setup, like a very, like, I don't know, Vogue Vanity Fair color scheme, and it's pretty mature. I think that this is a mature color scheme, and that's what they were going for again with this video. And then we have our opposite color of green is red, so in this case they've shifted red towards blue to make it a little bit more purple. This is a pretty saturated color. This is the most saturated color, like, with this couch, though in color correction I think they probably pulled up this green and pulled up this magenta to make those pop. And then her skin is pretty white and desaturated, so not a lot of red in her skin. So it's a cool color correct. I don't know the colorist, I didn't get to talk to him or her, but I can pretty much tell that that's what's going on here. And what else? So the key light you can see in her eye, it's pretty frontal. So meaning, like, so this is the camera, the light's like pretty much behind the camera like this, versus being from the side, it's very much from the back. And you'll see that there's basically no shadow because of that style of lighting. And this is a way more open, way more a beauty style of lighting that's going on. Here's a side shot, so we'll see that the light is gradating this way, so starting bright up here and then getting less bright over there. And we can see that the shadow is indeed buried behind or under like this. So when we flip back to this shot, you just don't see it because it's hidden to camera. So another wide shot, kind of cool. This is a little bit bright. To me, it feels kind of, I guess it's cool. You're showing the gradient. It's definitely a style, an intentional style. So this lighting setup, so unfortunately when you do big book lights and big soft lights like this, is you end up boxing them in like that to stop the spill. And what that means is they take terrible set photos. You can't see what's going on. Kind of sucks. I'll draw through. We have our solid that's going to block all the spill, and this is our 12 by diffusion in the front, and we'll go to black. And then inside here, again, is like a big HMI. It might just be like an M40 or even a 1.8. Could be a 1.8. I mean, they're pretty high ISO. And then there's a bounce in there. So this is bouncing off of that bounce, like that that ultra bounce we saw before. And then that's bouncing back through the diffusion. That's called the book light. We'll talk about book lights more specifically in another video or course. But just so you guys know, this is when you would use a book light. And that's what it looks like. It's really soft. Moving on, this is just inside of the whole scene again. Not much more to say. Kind of a cool view of the two-axis lambda. You see that Peter can basically walk with the camera and just float it around wherever he wants. Pretty dynamic and interactive way of shooting. I like doing this as well. I got to try out the Z-Jib. Again, 24 frames per second, 180. And, you know, basically a white color balance. So white is white. And actually, looking at this monitor raw, maybe it's just her makeup and her skin tone is pretty pale in general, and this stuff is pretty saturated already. So maybe in color correction they had it up, maybe it was just good art direction on camera. I would believe that from Sophie Muller for her to be that on top of the color. So moving on to the third lighting setup, we're gonna do four, this is the third one. This is what I'm calling skylight, and the lighting is clearly coming from this direction. I'm gonna call out the shadows here, maybe in black. So there's shadow there, shadow there, shadow here, shadow under her chin, shadow there, and then this is being shadowed as well. And that basically means that the light's coming from this direction and pretty toppy. It's pretty cool. So overall, the way that Peter's been lighting this is he creates one big source with a direction, a strong direction depending on the shadow and the shape that they want out of the scene. And then he kind of locally comes in with a Kino Flow with some opal on it and fills in where he needs to do. That's basically how this entire music video is lit, and I like that approach. It's simple, allows you to move quickly, and it's beautiful. You don't need a ton of lights. These are like all almost two or three lighting setups, you know, meaning there's two or three lights in this lighting setup. So moving on here, here's another shot. And what's happening here, I'm unclear if this was post or if this is in camera. It looks like it's in camera. But you'll see that the focus is very soft here, very soft here. What's actually happening is that there's a focus plane there. So usually the focus plane, if you're looking at the camera, the focus is this way. It's along this plane. But what he does is he's basically shifted it like that. This is a tilt shift lens does this. If it was in camera or it was in post, I'm not sure. But anyway, the focal plane is here so that you'll see that her chin's out of focus, that's out of focus, and then this is all out of focus, and that's all out of focus. So we have this line here of focus, and that's what a tilt shift lens does. Another shot of the monitor, again, the focus plane is here right now. So defocus in this direction, pretty cool. Very, supposed to be like expressionist and a little bit more painterly, so someone named Vermeer, I get. he got to go for the painterly look, same settings. And here's the actual lighting setup. So we have a book light here, 12 by diffusion, 12 by ultra bounce. Inside of this is a PAR, HMI PAR of some sort, bouncing here, bouncing out. And this setup, it looks like it's off. Not using the book light, I guess. but we have, what is happening is we've got this 1.8 or maybe 4K HMI. It's a big HMI-ish, kind of a small HMI actually. And it's bouncing off of this ceiling here. I'll switch to black. So it's bouncing up there. And then clearly the light is coming down in this direction. So there's no direct light. It's just bounced into the ceiling above her and it comes down in this soft way and it looks like that. So pretty cool. There might actually be some real daylight happening here and here, and there's maybe a real skylight up there, I'm not sure. But in either case, there's a big bright source from this top direction and coming down. So this moves us to our last setup. Always sad to be on the last setup, you know. I like doing these, but we gotta get to the last step eventually. What's happening here is we're essentially looking up at Selena Gomez, and it's not really clear in just the video what's happening, but she's in bed. And more or less, you're in bed with her. That's kind of the idea, I think, with what's going here. And we also see why they chose this location is that we have this beautiful roof. Did I just say roof weird? So we see these like nice white wood beams. And there's this nice skylight up here that Peter's definitely utilizing. And the art department pretty much came in and added these globe spheres? These like gold chrome sphere ornaments to give a little bit of interest and breakup and make it look like someone's living here. It's not just like an empty loft, which it definitely is. So we're seeing edge light from that window. There's a sun back here. And then from this direction is a very soft light. Pretty cool setup. And then here's this actual sun. And again, look how this lens is flaring, or look how it's veiling. As a DP shooting music videos, if you're going for these kind of looks, you need to basically go to a rental house and just flare the out of a bunch of lenses and find out which ones do this, which ones flare differently, which ones do you like, which ones are right for the music video. That's what's going on. Good DPs, they just know it. I guess I'm not a good DP because I don't really know all the flares all that well. So here's our behind the scenes of the setup. So Selena Gomez sitting here, there's Peter with the camera looking up at her. And then here's the main key light. Another book light, another 6x book light. HMI, pretty straightforward. And then we can even see here, I don't know what color to call it out with, there is the Kino Flow kind of filling in again. So almost every lighting setup so far has been maybe using some natural light as a backlight. But more or less he creates one source from one direction with a book light. That's like the main direction that gives most of the shadow, and then you just fill in a little bit with that Kino Flow. Pretty cool technique, I like it. And so now is a good time to talk about our camera. This is an area mirror, clearly. Nice Alexa Alev sensor, shooting to log C. It does a good job with skin tones, and we're usually shooting skin tones, so that's why this camera's getting used a lot. There's a wireless focus motor here. Is that a Preston? Looks kind of small to be the Preston MDR. Monitor to view the shot at a low angle. And here's our lens. I still don't know what lens this is. It's small, it's vintage, it flares nicely, so there's probably, you guys tell me. You tell me what this lens is, I don't know. Here's our last setup of the whole thing, sad to say. Again, Peter over here, being a boss, shooting Selena Gomez. Our big, beautiful key light. Looks like a 12 by now that I look at it. And then here's the shot. Again, very edge lit. There's probably some atmosphere in here to be able to see this stuff. See some of the sun rays. Really dynamic 3-point perspective shot. I'm not gonna get into what the different types of perspective are, but when you look up, typically you have 3-point perspective, especially with a wide lens like this. My guess, My guess is this is a 24 millimeter lens. Might even be wider, might be more like an 18, I'm not sure. So, that is gonna wrap it up for our look at Selena Gomez. Good for you. This is a really beautiful video and definitely a little bit more mature photography happening here in that we're allowed to go a little bit dark. It's not so much of that front lit pop beauty stuff happening. And it's not really like the DP's choice on which one you go with that. Usually when you talk to the director, there's a pretty clear direction that you want to take. And this one, Peter was allowed to go dark to kind of imply this more mature narrative type of photography. And my takeaway from this is that as you approach scenes like this, where it's really about the talent, it's really about beauty, you want to keep it simple and you want to keep the light sources kind of far away. And you have this kind of natural interaction that's happening with the camera and with the talent. So you can get close, you can get far away. You can do that dynamically and you kind of dance with the talent as they're performing. It's a really fun way of doing it. It's one of the best reasons to shoot music videos is like, say you're a fan of Selena Gomez or the artist and you like the song, you're in there performing with them in a way. It's really fun, it's cool. And Peter, again, big book light, choose your direction. Is it from the top? Is it from the side? Is that a little bit too shadowy? Want to get a little bit more niceness in there? Add to the fill light with the Kino Flow. So I hope you guys like this breakdown. I personally learned a lot. I learned a lot from doing these. I hope you like them. If you did, like the video, subscribe to the YouTube channel. I'm gonna be trying to do these once a week. I'm gonna stop doing music videos, or not stop, but I'm gonna do some commercials. There's some other people that I wanna break down their work and there's really cool stuff out there. Also head to cinematographydb.com, sign up for the newsletter. Thanks so much for staying with us and watching this video. Really appreciate it. I'll see you on the next episode. This is my IKEA standing desk, guys. And when you have a standing desk that's motorized, you can do things like this. That's the rich one. That's obvious. I'm in my marquee diamonds. I'm a marquee diamond. Could even make that Tiffany jealous. You say I give it to you hard. So bad, so bad. Make you never wanna leave. I won't, I won't. Gonna wear that dress you like. Skin tight, do my hair a brew real nice. And syncopate my skin to how you're breathing.